There was a singing group years ago called The Last Chapter of Acts. I wish they could have been here this morning. That would have been wonderful. Was it last? No, the second chapter of Acts is what they were called, I think. We'd have gone past them years ago. The scripture that we have today is very pictorial, if you would. There's a visuals that we'd want to see a little bit in it, but I'm not going to go into great depth, and I don't know that we were supposed to. You see, the last chapter of Acts is open ended. It's kind of like the history stopped here for some reason. You go, why did the history? And history didn't stop here. History goes on. There are books, there are historical books, there are other places that you can find more about what took place in Paul's life over the next 5 to 7 years and what tradition or history tells us was his demise sometime just before the fall of Jerusalem around AD 70. Well, the end of this history book that we have, Acts is a book of actions, and it's over about almost a 40-year period of actions. And the actions that were taking place were actions that were establishing the gospel of Jesus Christ and the church. We are part of the church, and we're part of that gospel that's going on. So in Acts, over this last year and a half, a little over a year and a half, almost a year and three-fourths, we've really seen a glorious journey. It's started with Jesus meeting with his disciples, his apostles, and ascending into heaven. And he told them, I want you to go into all the world and I want you to teach. And there will be an order in which I want you to preach the gospel. I want you to start in Jerusalem, he said in Acts chapter 1. And then I want you to go to Judea. And then I want you to go to Samaria. I always love that word. Samaria. I want you to go to Samaria. And then I want you to go to the ends of the earth, or to the uttermost part of the world. Now, if there were a hub of information for the world, from at least this portions of the world's perspective, Rome would be that. It was the internet hub. It was a communication hub. It was a hub of commerce. It was a hub for many different things, and it was a hub because there was power there, and there was power there for many years. And so we have the gospel going through all of this. It was first sent out through the powerful preaching of Peter, and Peter is we hear his sermons in Acts chapter 2 and 3 all the way through Acts chapter 10. And 11, we hear about Peter and what takes place as he talks to other people. We hear examples of sold out men who are servants. They called them deacons. The word deacon actually means servant, and so they called them servant. They were ones of, in Acts chapter 6, of service, of diakonos, or of service. And as these men showed us what it means to be a servant, we found that some were table waiters, and some of those who were table waiters also took the message out, just like Philip did when he took it to the Ethiopian treasurer, and he shared Christ with him, saw him baptized, or actually Philip baptized him. Another miracle took place. Philip headed from that area, like disappeared. I didn't see him anymore, and he appeared over on the Gaza Strip, what is the Gaza Strip today. We saw the persecution of brave believers in Acts chapter 7 and 8. They were persecuted by a man named Saul at the time. Saul was a Hitler-type guy. He was a guy that was power-hungry somehow, and now he might have had great motives, and that might have been a great, terrible thing to say against him. But one thing that I know is that he murdered men, he murdered women, he separated families, he separated mamas and put them in jail from their babies. He was not a good guy. He said, I was the worst. I was the chief of the sinners, the worst of the sinners. And yet Jesus Christ chose him, and Paul then had a choice whether to follow the call of Christ. And as he said, yes, I do believe that you are the Son of God, on the road to Damascus, he had this time of a life change in which he became one of the boldest, one of the most bold believers for Jesus Christ. We saw the salvation of this worst persecutor of the church in Acts chapter 9, and then the missionary's message of Paul carried out from Acts chapter 13 through 28. So the book of Acts was not all about Paul, but if you've only been here for the last 6 or 8 months, you'd say, well, this is a book about Paul. It was not a book about just Paul. It was a book about the message that Paul was given a responsibility to share. And it's a book about the message that that Peter was given a responsibility to share. It was a book about the message that Philip and Stephen were given a responsibility to share. It's a book about the message that the apostles were given a responsibility to share. I walk backwards, but coming back to today, it's a book about the message that you and I are given the responsibility to share. I almost brought a chain up here, and I'm going to close with this thought in a moment. I almost brought a chain up here, maybe two chains, with a link that's missing in between. And you know how they have those little links you can buy that you can kind of screw together and you make it a solid link? I wanted to bring a chain on one side and a chain on the other side and say, we're the missing link. Scientists have been looking for a missing link for a long time. They're missing the whole chain, by the way. But the missing link in the gospel message is us. If we don't do it, then the chain breaks, and there might not be a chain that goes into the generations ahead. The apostles knew that. The disciples knew that. The disciples of Jesus Christ, and then those who are carrying the message around the world. This is a neat day for you to be here. Acts chapter 1:8 is where that message was given. Jesus said to the apostles, you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. The day that you accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, though you may not, and I'm certain that you do not have the same ability that the apostles had to be bitten by poisonous snakes and not die from it, to drink cyanide or poisons and not die from it, but they were given that ability to show that this gospel message is of God and of Jesus Christ. But the same power that they were given in the Holy Spirit is given to us. We have received power with the Holy Spirit coming upon us. And that power is greater than the miracles that Jesus did. What you've been given, the responsibility and the opportunity to do, is greater than the miracles that Jesus did. Jesus said to his apostles, he said, you've seen the things that I've done, but greater things will you do. Now, how can we do greater things than Jesus? You see, Jesus hadn't died on the cross yet. The message of salvation and the price hadn't been paid. Eternal life was not being given in the same way through Jesus Christ under the old covenant. It was eternal life that they were given. They were saved by grace through faith. Hebrews chapter 11 and 12 deals with that. But the apostles were going to be giving to individuals the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and to everyone who received it, they would receive something that no people had received in a permanent fashion in all of history prior to that, and that is the Holy Spirit. They have never received, their bodies were never the temple of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit always dwelt in another place, spoke to them through a burning bush, through a cloud, through many different things from external, but he didn't speak to them from the inside out. Just a few people in history were given that temporary messages, and the temporary messages were given to kings and prophets. They wrote those things down because those messages were to be given to us. But today we're given messages every day as we walk through life. Things that convict us, things that encourage us. The greater power that we were to do is given to us. And because of that, Acts chapter 1:8, just before Jesus ascended into heaven, he said, and you'll be my witnesses. You are going to be. You in these temporary vessels called bodies, all so fragile and so temporary and so subject to sin and carnal life, so subject to desiring the things of the world, you're going to be my witnesses, and you're going to do it in Jerusalem and Judea and Samaria and to the end of the world. And they did that. Now, when we get to the end of this, we'll see what our responsibility is. As we reach the end of Acts, the story is coming to an end. We know that Paul was going to face Caesar because the Lord, an angel of the Lord, literally told him, you are going to go before Caesar, and he did. But we don't get to see him go before Caesar in the scripture here. We know he would face Caesar, but it was not documented by Luke. Why not? That would be really interesting, wouldn't it? It might be our focus. We might think that the book of Acts was all about getting the message into Paul and getting the message to Caesar, and it was done. But it's not done. It's open-ended because we still have this responsibility. That was the message that I drew from today. So we know that Paul was under arrest. He was in Rome for at least 2 years, and then he left. He must have had some freedom in order to do some other missions, and then he was arrested again. And when he was arrested again, then he wrote the book of 2 Timothy, and he said in 2 Timothy 4, he said, now the time for my departure has come. He never wrote that while he was in Rome here. He said, the time for my departure has come, and I know that I'm about to go. Timothy, I'm leaving these things in your care. It's his pastoral letters to Timothy. And then he said, but you know what? My journey was worth it. I fought the good fight. I finished the race and I kept the faith. And I know that there's a crown of righteousness awaiting me. He was ready to go to be with Jesus. He was ready to go home to be with the Lord. And at that time, in another imprisonment, we don't know exactly how many imprisonments he had. There are several historical books, even one that I reviewed this week, that talked about the things that took place after this and documents that have been found that documented some of his missionary journeys. Well, let's get to this and get done. So history tells us that Paul did have a demise. He's not still alive today. He didn't die of old age. He died, if history is correct, at the hands of Nero, somewhere outside of Rome, a few miles outside of Rome. He was beheaded. He knew that he could have died in Jerusalem. He could have died back in Philippi or Ephesus or Corinth. He could have died in any of these places. And he thought he was going to probably die in Rome because he knew that he had a message to take to the kings. And that's what ended up happening, but it didn't happen yet. Acts chapter 28, verse 11. Last week, we left him on the Isle of Malta. Malta was this place. Malta literally means honey. I talked to you about what you can see historically, that it was a land that was prolific for three things: for its honey, for its goat's milk, and a breed of goat that gave a whole lot of milk for some reason. They just walked around leaking everywhere. And for sails, S-A-I-L, that you'd put on ships, so a very heavy garment material that they used then for sails for ships. At Malta, they had gotten there somewhere around early November, I think. It might have been beyond that. We were calculating the time based upon the feasts that were taking place. It might have been, I think it was late October, early November. The storms, they shouldn't have been traveling by this time because the Mediterranean Sea is terrible whenever you're, even today, they don't travel between basically what you'd see as November or late October and March. The Mediterranean is not open for travel during that time. However, the coastal areas that you'd have well over there around where Israel was and on up to Asia Minor, and then the coastal areas from Malta that go on up past Sicily and then to the boot of Italy, you would do coastal travel. So you could do that about a month later, and that's what they thought they were doing before when they got shipwrecked, but you could travel a month later by ship if you follow the coastal waters. You could also travel a month earlier, and so this 3 months here took us somewhere around from November to somewhere around February. They were traveling about a month before anybody could have come across the Mediterranean from Greece or Jerusalem, from any Asia place over to Rome. They just didn't travel yet there. And that's important to the story in a second. Acts 28:11. After 3 months on the Isle of Malta, now about February, we set sail in a ship that had wintered on the island of Malta, a ship of Alexandria with twin gods as a figurehead. I didn't go into great detail of this, but there were two sons of Zeus. Their names are not important. There were two sons in Greek mythology of Zeus that were supposed to be the protectors of ships and sailors. And sometimes they would put those two sons as statues somewhere on there. They would carve them on the side. They would put their names or something to say, protect our ship, Zeus. Obviously, those things didn't help a whole lot. But it says the twin gods were the figurehead. So this was a prominent ship that had wintered at Alexandria, and it was going to sail on towards Rome. So they were sailing north. Sicily is what would look like a large island with a little peninsula in between there called the Straits of Messina. From Sicily, in between this boot of Italy, and they were going to make their way through there and try to make their way up to Rome. Got the visual. Putting in at Syracuse, which was on Sicily. So they went from Malta to Syracuse on Sicily. It's an excellent harbor. It was a strong harbor with a 14-mile wall around the harbor. This must have been a pretty excellent, amazing place, even for that day. Paul said we stayed there for 3 days, and from there we made a circuit and arrived at Rhegium. Now, this is on the toe of the boot of Italy. It's at the southern entrance to this strait that goes across, the Straits of Messina. After 1 day, and that was like a canal, if you would. And it may be a whole lot larger than a canal. I only saw it on a map that was this big. But it's like a little canal that goes in between the boot of Italy and Sicily there. After one day, there was a south wind that sprang up at Rhegium on Italy. They're on the land. Basically, they're at the land that if they walked it, they could go on up to Rome, but it would take them a long, long time. After one day, a south wind sprang up, and we went from the boot toe of Italy, heading on up. The second day, we came to Puteoli, something like that. It means sulfurous springs. It must have smelled like somebody passed gas. I'm not sure. But this was a town. Maybe that's why they called it Puteoli. I'm not sure. But it means sulfurous springs. And he said, there we found brothers, and we found people who were Christians already. Now, the gospel message had been sent to these places before. It literally had been sent there. Paul himself had written a letter to Rome. That letter was like, it was the Bible for them. It was the gospel from Jesus Christ to the prophet, Paul himself. And so many people probably had read that. We don't know where these Christians came from, but when he called them brothers, he didn't say Jewish brethren or whatever. He said brothers. These were Christians. Well, they invited us to stay with them for 7 days. Remember, Paul is still under arrest. There's a centurion there, which means he is the Roman guard over a century of men or 100 men. There are a number of prisoners. We don't know how many prisoners there were, but there could have been 100 prisoners. There was 276 people that were on that shipwreck, all of them saved. The sailors wouldn't have been a part of this group that stayed at this town called Puteoli, but the rest of them were there, so there could have been a couple of 100 people there. We stayed with them for 7 days. It was probably a welcome break from all the travels that they did. And so then they walked from there up to Rome. As they walked from Puteoli to Rome, it would be a 5-day journey. And Paul probably was grateful. He had gone through 4 shipwrecks. He had been lost at sea several times and floated out on the sea, maybe from those shipwrecks, maybe from something else like he got thrown overboard, but 4 shipwrecks. As they came to Rome, they decided to walk from Puteoli to Rome. And verse 15 says, and brothers from there met us on the journey when they heard about us. Remember, there's a church at Rome that Paul had written to. Paul, the prophet, the one who gave you the most valuable text that you've ever received as a church, personally received as a church. Paul, the prophet, is coming. Oh, he's under arrest, but he's coming from all the way from over to Jerusalem. He's made his way over to here where you are. So Christians came out. They wanted to meet him. And when they heard about us, verse 15 says, they came as far as the Forum of Appius. It was about 43 miles from Rome. It was called the Marketplace, south of Rome. And the Forum was apparently a city or a town, not a city necessarily, but a town that housed what was probably like 30 miles or potentially 30 miles and much market in information, much things that people could and did need in their lives. And so they would go down and they would even shop in this area. They came as far as the Forum of Appius and Three-Day Taverns. Now, 10 miles north of the Forum of Appius was a place called Three Taverns to meet us. How many of you have ever been into a place that had 3 taverns close together? I don't know what that actually means. It could have been 3 bars. It could have been 3 hotels. It could have been 3 restaurants. But it was called 3 taverns, and that's about all that we know about it. But we do know that it's still around there, about 33 miles south of Rome. People came to meet Paul. On seeing them, Paul thanked what? Verse 15 says, on seeing them, Paul thanked God. When I think of you, I am grateful for things that you do for the sake of the gospel, but I thank God for you. See, the glory doesn't go to us and the glory didn't go to them, but Paul was so grateful that there was something that was working even ahead of where he was, and he was really encouraged by that. That's what the verse says. Paul thanked God and took courage. Verse 16 says, when we came into Rome, and there must have been a horde of people by this time who were traveling together, the centurion was, and the soldiers were delivering their prisoners. They didn't lose any prisoners in the shipwreck. They didn't lose any prisoners on Malta. They didn't lose any prisoners, period. And they came to bring those prisoners as the captain of the guard to Rome. Paul was allowed to stay by himself, by the way, with the soldier who guarded guarded him. Now, why would Paul stay by himself? The reason is Paul was a Roman citizen. Most of those prisoners may or may not have been. Probably not. They were going possibly to Rome to have to stand y'all tell me what it was, the stadium, what do you call that? Colosseum. They might have been ones who were taken out in the Colosseum and they had to fight for their life, or they had to stand out there and be torn up by lions. This was not a pretty day to live in, especially if you were condemned to death. Paul had been accused and charges had been brought against him for death, but the Romans said, we don't find any reason that this man should be condemned to death. He had some freedoms, though he was still under guard because he was having to face these charges. But there were no papers that came with him that said these are the charges. There were no accusers who had made their way across the Mediterranean since these people had traveled in the winter. Nobody was going to get there for a while. Apparently, nobody got there to bring charges against him for about 2 years. So as they got to Rome, Paul was allowed to stay by himself with a soldier who guarded him. Based upon other letters that he wrote, we know that there was a changing of the guard. There was not one soldier that was there all of his life. There apparently was a changing of the guard that compilated in 6 different guards being chained to him as the day went on. He had a captive audience with somebody with a chain around his waist, ankle, I don't know how they did it, but there was a guard that was on the end of that chain. And what did Paul do every time a guard came in and was on the end of the chain? He told them about Jesus. And the guards went, man, you're a good guy. I don't know why you're in this. He said, oh, no, people just didn't like me. I'm talking about a Messiah. I'm talking about a hope for Israel. And that really cobbed the leaders in Israel because they didn't want to give up their power. He talked to them. He told them about Jesus. And all of a sudden, he started to have a relationship with multiple guards because there was at least 6 guards. Some say there were 2 guards, one on each side. And so he had twice the audience. And all of a sudden, he was a man that was making an impact on Caesar's household because the guards that were guarding him when he was in Rome were guards from the palace. After 3 days in Rome, Paul called together the local leaders of the Jews. Now, see, the Christian brothers had already greeted him. Oh, there was a celebration. But after 3 days, he went, okay, I guess it's time for me to throw the Puteoli into the fan. And he called together I'm not sure what Puteoli means. He called the local leaders of the Jews together. And when they had gathered, he said to them, fellow Jews, brethren, my brothers, though I had done nothing against our people, the Jews, or the customs of our fathers, I was delivered as a prisoner from Jerusalem into the hands of the Romans. Well, what did you do? When they examined me, the Romans wished to set me free. They said, we don't have any reason to keep you here, but because there was no reason for the death penalty in my case. In other words, false charges were brought, and there was no reason for a death penalty. But he said the Jews over in Jerusalem, and he's talking to Jews, remember this, because the Jews of Jerusalem objected, I was compelled to appeal to Caesar, though I had no charge to bring against my nation. I didn't countersue. I didn't tell him that the people were falsely accusing me. As a Roman citizen, he could have pulled the pin, if you would, on a hand grenade against the Jews and say, me as a Roman citizen have been done wrong by these Jewish people. And he could have basically thrown that Caesar grenade into Jerusalem. And there could have been a lot of bloodshed for the sake of what they had done against Paul. But he didn't do that, he said. I had no charge to bring against my nation. For this reason, verse 20 says, therefore I've asked to see you. I just appealed to Caesar. It is because of the hope of Israel that I'm wearing this chain. He's talking to Jewish people. It's because of the hope. To the Israel brothers and sisters, he's saying, you know that everything about our culture, everything about our religion, everything about our belief says that there's a Redeemer that was to come. There's a Messiah coming for us. There's a King coming. And I'm telling you that it's because I'm preaching for the sake of the King who is coming, the hope of Israel, that I'm in chains today. Wow. And they said to him, we've heard about this sect this sect of believers that, and they called them a sect because the Jerusalem believers, the Israelite people who are still under the old covenant, or thought they weren't anymore, but who thought they were still trying to keep the old covenant, they saw Christendom as something that was false. They saw it as a religious sect, something that probably needed to be getting rid of. But these people didn't respond quite like the folks in Jerusalem did. They didn't respond like the folks in Ephesus or some of the other towns did. The way these Jews responded was kind of more like what took place in Corinth. In other words, they said, well, tell us a little more about it. They said, we received no letters in verse 21 from Judea about you, and none of the brothers coming here has reported or spoken any evil about you. We just don't know much about you, Paul. But we desire to hear from you and what your views are with regard to this sect. We know that everywhere it's spoken against. Everywhere in their circle it was spoken against. But everywhere in the Christendom of Jews and Gentiles, it was spoken of as something very positive. Well, verse 23 says, when they appointed a day for him, they made a special appointment. They came to him at his lodging in great numbers. All of the Jewish, the Hebrew Old Covenant Christians came in great numbers. And from morning until evening, he expounded to them or explained to them about the kingdom of God, testifying to them about the kingdom of God. Now, this testimony about the kingdom of God would start with Christ to tell them, you must receive Jesus. But if you receive Jesus, he is going to come back as our Messiah. He died as a sacrificial lamb. He's seated before the Father today as a priest, interceding for us, and he's going to come back as King of Kings and Lord of Lords. When he comes back, he is going to bring back with him all of those who are dead already. Their bodies are going to meet together, and he told them the details that Paul laid out in all of his writings. The things I know today, I could tell you from all of the works of Paul, because this is what he was teaching them. This is what he was telling them. And he was telling them, when Jesus comes back, he's going to come back with a reign. The word kingdom here is not something that is abstract, and it's not talking about a place. The kingdom of God is talking about the reign of God. And I'll give you the explanation of this. I looked up kingdom in a Bible concordance called Strong's Concordance. It says this word kingdom is not talking about a castle or a kingdom like that, or even a kingdom of people. It's talking about a royal power, a kingship, a dominion, or a rule, but not a physical people. Now, keep in mind, not to be confused with an actual kingdom, but rather the right or the authority to rule over a kingdom. So it's dealing with the word reign, R-E-I-G-N. It means of the royal power of Jesus as the triumphant Messiah. That's how Paul was using it. Of the royal power and dignity that will be conferred on Christians in the Messiah's kingdom. I give you the responsibility to do this, responsibility to do that. You take charge of 10 cities. You take charge of 5 cities. You sweep up gold because we've got pavement everywhere. Remember, the streets were made of gold. He talked about things that were to come, and Paul knew. He saw. He had details from heaven as he spent time with God. The last of the definitions in Strong's Concordance, it says, used in the New Testament, the word kingdom is used in the New Testament to refer to the reign of the Messiah. What Paul was telling these folks is that this Messiah, this hope of Israel, is going to return. And he's going to return as King of Kings. He told us he's going to go back. The apostles saw him ascend into heaven. And then Paul said, he taught me. He taught me for about 3 years. Verse 23 goes on, the last part says, trying to convince them about Jesus through the law of Moses and through the prophets. Paul knew the Old Testament. He knew the law and he knew the prophets as good as anybody. He was a studier of these things. He was highly educated, and he was one of the highest educated men in things that we would call the Old Testament. He walked through the Old Testament. He said, let me tell you about why God killed animals to cover the shameful nakedness of Adam and Eve after they sinned and fell short of the glory of God. It was a picture that one day there would be a lamb's blood that would cover us. He talked about how Moses, who had a speech impediment, at him. And Moses said, I can't lead people, God. I don't speak so good. And God said, you are my chosen vessel to lead my people. Oh, by the way, I want you to take a lamb and I want you to kill it and put it over the doorpost. I want you to put it at the top and on the sides of the door, just like there would be blood at the top of the cross where the crown of thorns was and at the sides where his hands were. Use that basin at the bottom full of blood, that bowl full of blood at the bottom. Dip a hyssop branch in and you put it up on the doorpost with a hyssop branch. It was a hyssop branch that was used throughout Scripture to depict something that had to do with cleansing. When Jesus got thirsty on the cross, they took a hyssop branch and they put vinegar on a sponge and lifted it up to him with a hyssop branch. In Psalm, I think it's Psalm 52, David said, purge me with hyssop and I will be whiter than snow. Cleanse me with that hyssop branch. It takes the blood and the application of the blood to the door. And that was the picture of the door's heart that we have today. Paul was telling them about things of the old covenant. He told them that when Abraham took Isaac up on the mountain, Isaac was a picture of Christ. The same mountain that Jesus died on, it was just earlier, 40 something years earlier, 50 years earlier from where Paul was sitting. But the fact was that Jesus died on the same mountain, on the same place, I'm convinced that Isaac was figuratively killed on. Paul told him that Isaac was a picture of Christ and that Isaac's mother Sarah was a picture of Israel who died and was set aside. God was a picture of Abraham and Isaac was to get a new bride to come into the household. And a chief servant like the Holy Spirit went out to procure a bride just like the Holy Spirit draws our heart and drew a new bride called Rebecca. And drew that beautiful lady into the household, and Isaac took her to his mother's household. That's us. We have this place. I could go throughout the Old Testament and many of the stories I know, and I know maybe 2% of what Paul knew of all of the Old Testament. Day and night for 2 years, he shared details about the hope of Israel all the way through the Old Testament, coming to the fulfillment of Jesus Christ in his birth that was prophesied. He told about the law, he told about the prophets, and he told them all of these details. Verse 24 says, some were convinced by the many things that he said. Others disbelieved. Well, I thought he was going to come back as a king. I can't see him come and die. And the disagreeing among themselves, I believe, well, I don't believe, well, I believe, well, I don't believe. They departed after Paul made one statement. He said, the Holy Spirit was right, Israel. The Holy Spirit was right in Isaiah chapter 6, verse 9 and 10 to say to your fathers through the prophet Isaiah, go to this people and say, you will indeed hear, but you'll never understand. You'll hear, but you won't understand with your heart. And you will indeed see, but you'll never perceive. You're not going to put the pieces together. And this is why. Verse 27, for this people's heart has grown dull. You have grown dull of hearing. You don't even want to hear the truth. With their ears, they can barely hear. Can you turn off your ears? I wish we had ear flaps. We could just turn off our ears. We wouldn't have to put earplugs in when we shoot guns that way. It'd be so much easier. But we can't turn off our ears. We try to turn off our ears by focusing on other things so that we're selectively listening. He said, your ears have become dull in that way. And your eyes, their eyes, they have closed. With their ears, they barely hear. With their eyes, they close. They willingly shut their eyes. I can't see you. You're not there anymore. You're gone. When you play hide and seek with children, the second they close their eyes, you are hidden. You can be right in front of them. If they kept their eyes closed, they would not know where you were. Anybody, I guess, wouldn't. But when they open their eyes, they're surprised. and you never left the place. The Israelites, they closed their eyes, willingly shut their eyes to things that were obvious. In other words, when he went through these things of saying Isaac was a picture of Christ, Moses was a picture of a redeemer, leading the people out to the promised land, the land of milk and honey. Remember we headed up on Malta? He talked about all of those details and they went, nope, I don't believe it. That I close my eyes to the facts. I close my eyes to the details that are laid out there. I'm just not going to take it in. And that's what the Israelite people did. Otherwise, verse 27, otherwise they would see with their eyes. All they have to do is look at it. The details, the facts are there. The history is there. And then they would hear with their ears. And if they would see with their eyes and hear with their ears, then Isaiah said on behalf of God, God's words, saying they would understand with their heart if they just look into it. they would understand. If they'd listen, they would get it. And they would understand with their heart. And then God said, and they would turn, and I would heal them. It was their choice to understand or not. So because of that, Paul said one of the most profound statements, I think, found in the Bible in Acts 28:28, when he said, because of that, I want it to be known to you that this salvation of God has been sent to the Gentiles. What was the responsibility and the right to be the firstborn of God, to receive a double portion? The Israelites were called the firstborn of God in Exodus chapter 4 and other places. He said, they have forfeited that right as the firstborn son. They will still be a child of mine, but the rest of the world, the next in kin, the next born, are going to reign with me. That's the message of the kingdom of God. So when the firstborn forfeits the right to reign in the family, because the firstborn should have reigned over the family, they forfeited that right has been given to us, and that's the message of the kingdom of God, the reign of God. Verse 29 is not found in most manuscripts, but it says, when he had said these words, the Jews departed, and they had much dispute among themselves, whether it's in your scripture or not. The reason it's not found in our scripture today, in most scriptures, is because it was not found in the earliest manuscripts. The oldest manuscripts have just been found within our lifetime. Verse 30 and 31 says, he lived there 2 whole years at his own expense. Because he was a Roman citizen, he had some freedoms. He was apparently in a place that was too small, I'm assuming. He was in a place that was too small, and he was under guard. And so he said, would it be possible for me to get a bigger place? If you get a bigger place, you got to pay for it yourself. And so Paul moved out to a bigger place, still under guard, still as a prison for 2 years. But he probably moved into a place that could house a whole lot more people, because he was a magnet for the church of that day. He lived there 2 whole years at his own expense, and he welcomed all who came to him. He provided a place for them. And he proclaimed the kingdom, the reign of God, teaching them about the Lord Jesus with all boldness and without hindrance. Would you think it was a hindrance if you were proclaiming the message of Jesus Christ, but you were in the Waxahachie jail or the Corsicana jail? Would you think it was a hindrance? You would think it was a hindrance, but the gospel was not hindered. The message was not hindered. Would you think it was a hindrance if you said, I don't speak so good like Moses? I can't talk very well, God, and or I look ugly, probably, or not very appealing, like little Paul did, and I killed a lot of people, God. Do you think you could still be a strong messenger for God like that? Do you think you could be a strong messenger to give a picture of the Bible if you failed history for a semester? You can't do that because I did that. But what I know is that God takes our weaknesses and he turns them into strengths. God takes the places where we feel inadequate and he makes us not just adequate. He is all that we are is the vessel. He is the one that fills us up and pours us out. You know what a vessel is? It's a cup. What value is there a cup? Have you ever tried to eat a cup? There's only a few of them made out of cookies somewhere in the world you can eat. Sometimes they put ice cream in them. And sometimes they put soup in them. They call them bread. But you can't eat a regular cup. A cup just sits in the counter, and it's of no value until you take it out and you fill it up with something. If you take out a cup from the counter and there's a roach in it, is that the one you want to fill up? No, you don't want to fill it up because there's a roach in it. He might have Puteoli'd in it. I don't know if that's a real word. I'm making up something that has to do with the smell of sulfur. You don't use a dirty cup. And all of our lives are cups for Jesus Christ. And when he looks across our church and he sees a roach or sin or garbage in you, he's not going to pick up that cup. He's going to reach for another cup. And he's going to say, this is the one I'm going to fill up with myself. And as he fills up that cup with himself, then it's able to be poured out. You're not supposed to do what I do, and I'm not supposed to do what you do. I can't do what you do, and you can't do what I do, because we have our niche. We have our responsibility, and we are supposed to fulfill those things. Paul was released from prison. He continued his message, and he continued his message so much so that he affected Rome. From prison there, he wrote what was called his prison letters, Ephesians, Philippians, Philemon, and Colossians, not necessarily in that order. He wrote these letters to those people, and to the church at Philippi, he said in Philippians chapter 4, verse 22, he said, "All the saints send greetings." All the saints of Rome are sending greetings to you. It sounded like he was happy that he was ministering without hindrance. And he added to that in Philippians chapter 4, 22, he said, "And all of Caesar's household says, hey." That's what I thought. Gomer says, "Hey, you know." The guy that works on the chariot said, "Hey." The Roman soldiers, they all wanted to say, "Hey." The cooks, they all said, "Hey." I hadn't got to talk to Nero yet. You know, he's a real rear end. But man, all the people, they say, "Hey." Because those that got to be around Paul in Caesar's household became brothers to him because of Jesus Christ. The message, the gospel, was not hindered. And though he was in prison, limited to the places that he could go and limited to the people that he could see, he became a magnet for Jesus Christ. He was in chains in a local place. And you may go, "I could be in chains one day, limited to a wheelchair." You're still supposed to share the gospel. That feels like your chains, doesn't it? There's a lot of things that we say, "I can't do this because I have this infirmity, or I have this problem, or I have this burden. I can't minister for you, God." Carry the chain, or just stay where you are and be a light, and people will come to the light. If Christ is lifted up, he draws all men to him, and he gave us responsibility. You see, Acts chapter 29 is us. See, Paul continued his ministry, but this isn't a message about Paul. It was a message about the gospel of Jesus Christ through the apostles, through Peter, through Paul, and through the rest of the world. And we are Acts 29, and we are the link that I talked about in that chain to carry this message forward. You honestly have a responsibility. I read about a pastor, and I can't remember his name right now. He was pastoring a church, and he poured out his heart in a gospel message like this that said, "We've got to do something. The message of Christ has to be sent around the world, and we've got to do something." And the people started getting up and walking out at the end of the service just like normal. Okay, we're going to go on to our lubies then or whatever. This was in the 1800s, I think. But as they headed out to whatever they had at that time to eat or do, he just cried out, "Stop! Stop! I just told you the gospel message has to be carried or it will not go out. There is no way that God has chosen for the gospel message to go out except through people." That's it. That's it. "Are you going to do it?" And they said, "He's kind of serious about this." He was serious about it. And from that started a missionary society that has sent out people all over the world because one church got off their butt and said, "We will be the link." And that's the message for us today. We are Acts 29. We are the church. We have what it takes. We do. If there were three of us, we have what it takes. But with 300, we have what it takes. Will you do your part? That's all it is. Let's pray. God, I thank you for the scripture. I thank you for the book of Acts. And I thank you for the actions of these people with the Holy Spirit working through him. The acts of the Holy Spirit, the acts of the apostles, the acts of Peter and Paul, the acts of Stephen and Philip. Lord, I thank you that you have given me inspiration as we walk through the book of Acts. And Lord, I pray that that inspiration would say to those who are sitting in this room, we've got to be the light. And there is nothing that will hinder the word of God. That's the way the book of Acts ends. With no hindrance, the gospel message continued. The only thing that can stop the gospel message is if we don't do it. If we get so busy with our stuff that we don't share Jesus, then the link is broken. Lord, may we do our part, and may we be the inspiration for other churches to share the gospel of Jesus Christ. I feel like, and we're going to go from this place, and I'm not going to holler stop, but I feel like some are going to walk out of this room and do nothing to help the missionary societies of the world. Lord, all that you're asking for us to do is not be something that we can't be. All we are is a cup, each one of us a vessel. Lord, may we pour out the cockroaches and the garbage that's in our life so that you will want to pick us up. We can't wash ourselves, but you'll wash us. You wash the feet of the disciples, and you wash our spirit. You wash our heart. And Lord, cleanse us and use us. Fill us up, pour us out, fill us up again, pour us out, fill us up again, and pour us out until the day that we go home to be with you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. Thank you for listening.